Okay, let's talk about software bugs. Everybody knows that software bugs can be super annoying, right? Like when you're using your phone and you were on Wi-Fi and you go out onto LTE and suddenly whatever app you're using stops working. Or like when you're trying to log into the website for your bank to do something and for whatever reason, it doesn't work properly. This is very, very annoying. But software bugs can also be way, way worse than just annoying. Consider, for example, the CrowdStrike outage from last year. For those of you who don't remember this, hospitals were offline, airports were offline, 911 lines were offline. It was total madness. And all of this happened because of a single software bug that CrowdStrike accidentally shipped out to all of their customers. Now, CrowdStrike themselves mostly escaped economic consequences from this event. You can't say that about TSB, a British bank which woke up one day to see that all of their millions and millions of customers were locked out of their accounts. Think about that for a second. All these people not able to pay their bills, not able to access any of their money. Needless to say, a ton of those customers quit. Their regulators fined them gazillions of dollars, and their executives were hauled in front of Parliament several times to answer questions. All of that because of a single software bug in a data migration. This is actually still not the worst economic consequence I know of for a company from a software bug. That would have to be Knight Capital, which woke up one day to see that they had lost $440 million. One of their trading algorithms had gone crazy and made some very bad decisions. And as a result, they went bankrupt, completely sold off for parts, company value went to zero. This was because of a single software bug. But there's things in the world that are more important than money, right? Like, for example, your lives. Do you remember the Boeing 737 MAX 8 disasters? What happened here was a whole bunch of airplanes suddenly went into dives and fought against any attempt by their pilot to make them fly straight. The result of that was two of those planes crashed, killing every single person aboard. Over 300 people died. This was the result of a single software bug. These planes had a system on them called the Maneuvering Characteristics Augmentation System, which, when it got missing data from one particular sensor on the plane, thought that the plane was going into a stall and did some crazy stuff in response to that. Planes in general, by the way, these days are just like big flying computers. So any bug on them can be very, very catastrophic. Please, all of you, think about that while you're flying home tomorrow. But this is actually still not the most gruesome story of a software bug that I know. That would have to be the Therac 25, which was a radiation machine used to treat cancer patients. It had a single software bug in it. The result is a bug called a race condition. It's actually very common. The result of that was that these machines gave patients hundreds of times more radiation than they were supposed to receive. That made a lot of people very sick, and several of them died in a really unpleasant way. So what all these stories have in common is I think they exemplify what Marc Andreessen meant when he said that software is eating the world. Software is not just apps on your phone or websites or computer games anymore. Software is running critical infrastructure. It's hospitals, banks, airplanes, you name it. And now we get to the really, really bad news, which I have actually saved, which is that all of this is about to get way, way worse because of AI, right? Because the thing is, when most people think about AI, they're thinking about like chatbots and image generation, because those are the most popular use cases. But actually, the most economically significant use case for AI is code generation. Just like if you ask ChatGPT to write you an essay, it'll produce an essay. In the same way, if you ask it to write some code, it'll totally produce some code for you. And just like that essay often looks pretty good at first, but then if you read it carefully, there's some parts in the middle that don't actually make any sense, and there's some references to articles that don't actually exist. In the same way, the code it produces is often full of all kinds of weird, subtle, very difficult to understand errors and misbehaviors, i.e., it's full of bugs. And increasingly, this code is getting taken, not looked at by any human being, and just shipped out into the world and running somewhere where it can cause all kinds of havoc. And the consequences of this we're going to be living with for years and years. OK, so now the question is, what are we going to do about all this? Or maybe a better question is, why haven't we already done something about it? Like, why does software still have bugs in it? Well, I can tell you one thing. It's not for lack of trying. In fact, software engineers try so hard to make high-quality software and to deal with the bugs in their software, they often don't have time to do anything else. All these stats I've got up on this slide come from real surveys of real engineers. And as an engineer myself, I can tell you they basically check out. And I think this is like really important. This is like very poorly understood outside of software engineers. I talk to business leaders all the time, people who run giant corporations. They may employ thousands of software engineers. And they have no idea that these teams are actually spending more time dealing with the consequences of old bad code that already exists than they're able to spend writing new features or moving the business forward. It's like a giant invisible tax on almost every part of our economy, and it's largely silent. OK, so what are these people actually doing? Like, what is this practically speaking? Well, there's a whole bunch of activities that go into trying to find and fix bugs. But the one that's the largest in terms of the effort that people put into it is software testing. What is software testing? Software testing is just where you take a piece of software and put it in a situation and then see if it does the right thing. How hard could that be? It's actually really hard for a few reasons that I'm going to give you quickly. So first of all, I kind of hit the ball there. I said you take your software and you put it in a situation. Which situation? How many situations are there? There's a lot of situations. The reason is, basically, every time a software program makes a decision between two options, you're essentially doubling the number of possible situations that software could get into. And most software programs, even very, very simple ones, are making many, many such decisions. So there are many such doublings. We call that exponential growth. And so the result is even a really simple computer program has more situations it can get into than like the number of atoms in the universe. So you're never going to be able to test all of these situations. In fact, you're never even going to be able to think about all these situations. That could be OK if you just made sure you were testing the right situations. But that gets us to the next problem, which is you're not. Because software doesn't just exist in the abstract. Software has to run on real hardware in the real world. And as soon as it's doing that, it encounters all kinds of unexpected situations that nobody thought about while they were writing the code. For example, if your software has to run on a phone, then it needs to be prepared for the network connection to that device to drop out at any moment because you went into a subway tunnel, right? That's an unexpected situation. Or if your software is running in a data center, many thousands of copies of it on the back end of some big company, then it needs to be prepared for really, really rare events, like a computer shutting down or like some bit getting flipped by a cosmic ray, right? Those sound like rare events, but once you've got thousands of machines in the picture, they become a statistical certainty. Again, these are not things that anybody is able to systematically think of all the possibilities of ahead of time while they're writing the code. And if they're not thinking about it while they're writing the code, they're not thinking about while they're testing the code either. And so these become unknown unknowns that cause chaos and havoc when they happen for the first time in the real world. There's a third reason that this is all very hard, and it's people like you and me. Users, right? When a programmer is writing code, they have some idea in their head of what the users are going to do. But human beings are very difficult to predict or control. And so as a result, once the software actually gets out there in the real world, people use it in all kinds of ways that the person writing the code never thought of. And that creates more unexpected situations, which can cause more craziness and more complexity. OK. So far, this whole discussion has been very, very abstract. What I want to do now is I want to ground it and make it really concrete by talking about a specific, simple computer program that you're probably all familiar with. That computer program is Super Mario Brothers. So if you've been living under a rock for the last 4 decades, then, okay, Super Mario Brothers is a game where you try and navigate this world, which is full of obstacles, and get to the goal, which in this case is that castle on the bottom right-hand side. All right, how would you test this game? How would you make sure that it's working correctly? It's not a trick question, right? Like, I mean, one pretty basic idea would be like, well, you could try playing the game, right? You could try and get to the end. If you're able to do all the jumps and get to the end and beat the game, that's like a pretty good sign that the game is basically working, right? And you, if you were sophisticated, you could then have a computer record you playing the game, like this trajectory here in white, and then you could replay that every time you change the game, and hopefully it would catch it if you broke something, right? And that is sort of a way of testing the game. Now, will it find all the bugs in the game? No, definitely not. For example, it will not find this bug in the game. Watch this. Did you see that? He just clipped through that wall. Let's watch that again in slow motion. You are not supposed to be able to teleport through a solid brick wall in Super Mario Brothers. So now the question is, why did our test not find that bug? Well, it's pretty obvious, right? We never even really went to that part of the game. And if we had gone to that part of the game, we definitely wouldn't have deliberately swum up against a wall and then pressed a really weird combination of keys to try to teleport through the wall. That's not how normal people play Super Mario Brothers. Only very strange people do that, or speedrunners, or whatever, right? But that's the entire point. That's like what I've just been saying. Once the game got out into the real world, people found ways of using it, people found ways of breaking it that the developers of the game never thought of and never would have tested for. So then what are we going to do about this? How do we solve this problem? Well, the basic approach that our industry has taken is to say, let's write lots more tests, right? Let's cover many more of these situations. But this is totally not a solution to this problem at all. I just told you before that the number of possible situations, in this case, the number of possible paths through Super Mario, is more than the number of atoms in the universe. So it doesn't matter how many tests you write, you're never going to, by accident, get to the one where you swim through a wall, right? There's another problem with this, too, which is each one of these tests that you add creates a maintenance burden for your whole team going forward forever. Let me show you why that is. Here's a video where I'm feeding the same test input into two copies of Super Mario Brothers, which are identical in every way. I wasn't expecting that. Except for one thing, we moved that block. Do you see that block? All right, now watch what's going to happen. Very quickly, these test inputs diverge because of what we call the butterfly effect in chaos theory, right? Small difference in initial conditions. The one on the right's already dead. The one on the left happily bouncing along, still testing our game. That was a tiny change that we made. We moved one single block, and it broke the test. Imagine if we made a more substantial change to this game. It would break every single test, right? And that problem, magnified 1,000x, affects every single software development team on planet Earth, and it's a huge drag on their productivity. Okay, so what are we going to do about this? Well, it's 2025. We have a hammer. Everything looks like a nail. That hammer is called? Yeah, that's right, AI. So unsurprisingly, people are trying to get AI to write more of these tests. But if you've been following what I've been saying for the last few minutes, you already know that that is not a solution at all. Because the AI is trained on human beings writing tests. And we just said that humans are really, really bad at writing tests that find the unexpected situations, that get off the happy path. AI basically just copies people. And so it just does more of the same. It produces more of these tests that are not solving the problem, and they're lower quality on average. And because you have a lot more of them, they are now creating an even larger maintenance burden for you going forward. So this is not a solution at all. It's like that old joke about the restaurant where the food is terrible and the portions are tiny. Like, having AI write a whole bunch of tests is like giving you giant portions of the awful food. It's not going to actually make you happy. So this is the problem that we were trying to solve when we decided to take a really, really fundamentally different approach to software testing. So at my company, which is called Antithesis, what we are trying to do instead is still use computers to test software, but in a very different way. What we want to do is exercise the program and explore it, sometimes doing normal things and happy things the way a normal user would, the way it runs in the world, and sometimes doing really unexpected things, mixing together order and chaos to systematically explore the behavioral possibilities of the computer program. You can see here the Antithesis system testing Super Mario Brothers. This is actually how we found that bug I showed you before. And you'll notice that sometimes it plays like a person, and sometimes it does crazy stuff like deliberately jump down a pit or run into a wall, because that's how you find real bugs in the real world. We don't obviously mostly test Nintendo games. They're just really easy to visualize and understand. It's a little harder to visualize when you're testing more abstract kinds of software, but we can still try. So this is an animation of Antithesis testing a really, really well-known distributed database. It's one that probably all of your companies use. But what's important about it is, and this is just part of a much larger test campaign, what's important about it is that while we are testing this system, running queries, inserting data, doing the things that human beings do with databases, we are also simultaneously getting it off the happy path. We're injecting thread pauses that are designed to find the kinds of concurrency bugs that made the Theract 25 poison hundreds of people. And we're deliberately injecting network problems, like happen when you go into a subway tunnel, and we're seeing if the database responds correctly, and we're seeing if the data is all still synchronized when we end that network problem and make it all work properly again. And those are just two examples of all the kinds of craziness that we do. And we do this all at scale, massively in parallel, thousands and thousands of such simulations ahead of time to try to find the bugs that will cause chaos and insanity in the real world long before the software actually makes it into the real world. So that's what we do. I'm going to be here for the rest of the day. My colleague Lori is actually teaching a class about this approach tomorrow. You should totally go watch her. She's awesome. Thank you all so much.